So I took some tears off my eyes and I put it on his forehead.
Listening to Let Your Voice Be Heard.
It's a logical fallacy, and I know that, but, you know, as always, and maybe the rest of the panel can tell you, I play a bit of the devil's advocate because I am the lone black Republican up here.
He just made a fool out of himself. I mean, you can look at Dennis Rodman and think he's making a fool out of himself.
You know Barack Obama, what he was like, anti-war, government...
Boy, that escalated quickly.
I got to jump into a rally to save a hospital here in Brooklyn in just a minute.
I stopped working on my dissertation the second my grandmother died.
I am a blazing liberal. Who can have a Republican-leaning ideology to give me enough beers.
No, I got to get you that Illuminati thesaurus. Once you get that, you're going to be able to speak in the same language I can speak.
Now, a white person with a criminal record is more likely to get a job than a black person without one.
What? Did we just become best friends?
Yep.
The point of financial stability and economic justice is that you're free from confines of society and you have more freedom and to make your own choices.
Just in general, people who have money tend to have more access to resources to be able to use in their defense versus people that don't have money. So you see a lot of, you know, lower, and that's really a class issue, and race does come into play.
This is Let Your Voice Be Heard right here on WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
This is a nation. Mr. President, you ought to know that this nation is more a tale of two cities than it is just a shining city on a hill. Maybe, Mr. President, if you visited some more places, maybe if you went to Appalachia where some people still live in sheds, maybe if you went to Lackawanna where thousands of unemployed steel workers wonder why we subsidize foreign steel. Maybe, Mr. President, if you stopped in at a shelter in Chicago and spoke to the homeless there. Maybe, Mr. President, if you asked a woman who had been denied the help she needed to feed her children because you said you needed the money for a tax break for a millionaire or for a missile we couldn't afford to use.
And we are back. So what you were just hearing right there was an excerpt from Mario Cuomo's July 1984 keynote speech at the Democratic National Convention. He was essentially giving a rebuttal to Ronald Reagan's Shining City on a Hill speech. And what's so striking about the speech that Mario Cuomo gave in 1984 that you were just hearing a piece of is that so many of the things that Mr. Cuomo brought up in that 1984 speech are just as relevant today. I mean, one of the last things you saw him there mention was, you know, you say this is a shining city on a hill, but, you know, I'd like you to go to some of these poor neighborhoods and you know, really this is more of a tale of two cities. And I think that's so relevant to today's conversation. The last thing he says there before we crop the clip is, you know, I would like you to explain to these people who are starving why you cut their access to food stamps, but we gave a subsidy out to a foreign steel company, you know, and that, honestly, he could have been speaking that line this year, and it would have been something similar. Why, you know, when the sequester happened, why are we cutting food stamps, but yet we're giving more tax breaks to millionaires and billionaires? So essentially the same concept, and it's something I'm going to loop back to at the end of this rant. But I do want to give sort of some background into Mario Cuomo. As you may, or if you don't understand why we're talking about this subject today, is unfortunately Mr. Cuomo passed away this week. He was 82 years old. He served three terms as the governor of New York. He presided over, you know, many, many different things. He was an unwavering liberal. He wielded his veto pen year after year. One of the things that he consistently vetoed was a bill that would have restored the death penalty in New York State. And that actually goes back to him defending a pair of defendants who were both sentenced to death early in his legal career. He was an attorney to begin with before he became governor. He actually got started in politics much later on in life than most people at 42 years old. He did toy with the idea of running for the White House first in 1988 and then again in 1992, but ultimately he decided against it, and Bill Clinton became the president when he was elected in 1992. I'll now answer that trivia question that I posed earlier. Nobody's called in, so I'm going to presume that nobody knows the answer to that. You guys aren't allowed to answer because I gave you the answer, but he was on Bill Clinton's list to replace Supreme Court Justice Byron White when Justice White announced his retirement, and he essentially told President Clinton he was not interested in the position, and the person who was nominated and who still holds that seat today is Ruth Bader Ginsburg, another New Yorker. So that's the answer to that trivia question. Some background. Mario Cuomo was born June 15th, 1932 in Queens, New York. He was the third and final child of immigrants that came from Naples, Italy. His parents owned a grocery store in South Jamaica during the Depression, so he really got to see and understand poverty firsthand, which is sort of what led his fight. So another thing you may not have known, which is very interesting, is he actually signed a contract with the Pittsburgh Pirates to play center field for them. And he was playing in their minor league, the Georgia Florida League, when he actually got hit in the face with a baseball. He was blinded for a week, and he ended up never playing baseball again. After that, he then came back to New York, where he attended St. John's University, actually where my mom went, funny enough. And then he went to St. John's University Law School. In 1952, he was married. He obviously has several children, one of which is Andrew Cuomo, who is now the current governor of New York State. And early in his legal career, he was a criminal defense attorney. He represented two death penalty defendants. And then at some point, he decides to run for office. That's the first time he ever runs, is 1974. He loses, actually. And then in 1977, he runs again. He actually runs against Ed Koch. And there's some dispute between the two of them, which I won't get into here.
Cause, vote for Cuomo.
What? Because at that point, I'm not really going to get into details, but needless to say, at that point, there was a lot of rumors circulating about whether or not Ed Koch was gay, and this was at a time where it really wasn't popular to be, or not, you know, more, I don't want to use the term popular, but mainstream, and so there were some signs that said, vote for Cuomo, not the homo, and,
wow.
But actually, Mario and his son Andrew both denied that that had anything to do with them, but it created a rift between him and
Koch,
which it's hung around for a long time. Eventually, they made up. And I would like to believe, if there is such a thing as a heaven, I know some people believe and some people don't, but if there is, I'd like to believe that they're up there having a cold one together right now, kicking it. He's most famous for this 1984 speech. Despite the things that he did as governor, the thing that he's most famous for is this 1984 speech. And, you know, I'm going to end it really with what I wanted to begin with, is this is what we really need to take away, is this idea of income inequality. Mario Cuomo was the son of immigrants. He saw firsthand what poverty was like following the Great Depression, and it made him an advocate for poor and middle class people. He fought hard throughout his governorship in New York. He culminated, you know, sort of in this, you know, obviously in this 1984 speech where he considered running for president. And the things that he brought up in that speech are just as true today. And they're really things that the Democratic Party needs to get back to at its core. And I know Stanley mentioned why, you know, he said, I sort of have a problem with his son, Andrew Cuomo. And a lot of liberals sort of have a problem with Andrew Cuomo because they don't find him to be liberal enough. They don't think he focuses enough on the issue of income inequality. And in fact, some will even say that he's sort of sold out too much to corporations, which is something his father may not have done. So really, I think the takeaway from this is that the Democratic needs to get back to these liberal roots and really focus on these popular issues that keep being raised by Senator Warren and Senator
right.
Sanders. And I know we're really out of time, so we're going to have to close there. Hey, Selena?
I was just going to say, like, he did an excellent job at maintaining his principles and standing up for liberalism, especially during the Ronald Reagan era, where Reagan was so popular and everything he said was almost golden and was valued. And he was like, you know what? I'm going to call you out. And I wish that we did have more progressives who are like, I'm going to call you out. Even call out people within their own party. I mean, we have Elizabeth Warren and we have people of that nature, but I think we need more. And I think that Mario Cuomo did an excellent job at by showing what it takes to be a leader and what it takes to stand alone at times.
No, Elizabeth Warren is the closest to him, and I don't even think that her rhetoric is as strong as that was, to be honest. But we got to get out of here, guys. If you want to hear us again, we're on podcast. You can find us LYVBH Radio on podcast. We love you.
On iTunes.
On iTunes. Thank you, and we will see you next week.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.